So, hi everyone, this is Paril from Project IMG, and today we have with us Dr. Avantika Chaitanya. Dr. Chaitanya has recently pre-matched into pediatrics at Mount Sinai Elmhurst, Queens. So, Dr. Chaitanya, without any further ado, I would first like to congratulate you on the big achievement and welcome you here on our platform.
Thank you so much, Paril. That's super, super sweet, and I'm excited to be here. Hi, everyone.
So, Dr. Chaitanya, before we start, why don't you introduce yourself and brief us about your journey till now so that the viewers can be more acquainted to it?
Okay, sounds good. So, my name is Dr. Avantika Chaitanya. I graduated in March 2021 and I applied for the last match. And it's been quite a journey. I started my USMLE journey when I was in my final year of medical school. So, that's kind of late as compared to almost everyone who will be probably watching it. Because I know a lot of people started like around second year or third year, but I wasn't very sure. So, I started mine only towards the end. So, it took me a lot of catching up to do. So, yeah, it's been almost two and a half years of studying and going for clerkships, electives, observerships. And I know that the journey is quite hard, but trust me, it's always going to be worth it at the end. As for, I guess, probably the timing of my steps, I took my step one in October of 2020. I took my step one of October 2020. And then I went, then I had done one elective already that was prior to starting my internship. And then I did two more. And then I finished my internship. So I finished my internship and I graduated in March 2021. And then I took my OET in June 2021. And then I also took my step two in October 2021. And I took my step three in May 2022. And I applied in September 2022. So that's a bit deep about my USMLE journey. But yeah, that's pretty much how it went.
That's really good. Like, worth all the time you spent on it, definitely.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so I actually wanted to ask you that how many programs did you apply to, and did you apply to all the categorical programs or the preliminary programs? Like, basically, what was the criteria you used while making your list?
So I first started off making my list by looking at like Master Resident, Frida, Residency Explorer. So I had all three opened and then I had an Excel sheet. So what a friend of mine who was also applying, so both of us kind of made a list and then compared it, and this is something that I would highly recommend, because then because there are so many programs, you'll end up missing something. It's always better to do it with like a friend or a co-applicant, because it really helps when you know when you're going through the program list together. So I applied to a total of 115 programs. All of them were categorical. I didn't apply to any prelim programs. I also didn't apply to any primary care tracks. I only applied to categorical. And the way I like you know chose the programs, they were around 148 programs in pediatrics with sponsored a visa. So among those, I kind of looked at how many of them have historically taken an IMG in the past, and do they have at least one IMG in the resident list in the past 3 years. So it took some time, because sometimes you have to go to the website and look up the resident lists and you know make sure that they have taken IMGs before. So a friend of mine and I, like I said, we split the work and we did that, which was very helpful. So we narrowed it down to around 110 to 115 programs. And some of them even had like, you know, some programs have requirements for USC as well. So some had like 12 months of USC was like a minimum requirement, which I didn't have because I only had 6. So, you know, all, seeing all of that, we had an Excel sheet and we kind of narrowed it down. So 115 was like the final number.
That's definitely great. So in your opinion, like, is being ECFMG certified before applying to match, is it like very, very important? And what was the your timeline that you followed till ECFMG application, like the ERAS timeline?
Right. So I was actually ECFMG certified in January 2022 itself, because I finished my step two last year. That was October 2021. So I would recommend definitely getting ECFMG certified prior to application. No matter, I know a lot of people say that you only need it before the match deadline, and it's not a, you know, it's not a compulsion, and it's definitely not, because it's not an absolute requirement. But I do say for us IMGs, especially as visa requiring IMGs, I think it definitely matters when they're viewing your application and it's complete. It really gives a good opinion as whether you have some exam pending or your certification is pending. It just, you know, it's always better to have the certification hand. And personally, I've seen people who had certifications pending and they didn't get as many interviews as the people who had, gotten certified. So I think that's probably something that I've seen personally during the cycle as well. So I would definitely get it. Recommend you to at least get certified prior to applying. But if you don't, it's not the end of the world. You can always email programs and tell them about your application status once you get certified. But definitely it's a advantage to have it prior. And I guess the timeline for certification, I applied through Pathway once, so that I needed to have my letter of good standing from my medical council as well as my OET score. So OET scores take around like 3 weeks once you take the exam for the score to be released, and your letter of good standing really depends on your medical council, but that process is not that, it doesn't take that long, probably takes a week or so. So once you apply for the pathway and they verify both these documents, your pathway will be approved within, mine was approved within a week, but it takes up to 2 weeks. So you can keep that as a deadline. And for certification, it takes, once your pathway is done and the step one and step two is completed, you're eligible to be certified. So the certification process itself takes around 2 to 3 weeks. And then you will get an email saying you've been certified. And then they mail the certificate to your house, wherever you're staying or whichever address you've put on your ECFMG. So that whole process itself takes around 2 to 3 weeks and extra 2 weeks for the pathway. So I would recommend probably keeping a month, month and a half for your entire certification process. And one tip is that you can always apply for your pathways beforehand. So you don't need to have finished both your steps to apply for the pathways. You can apply for the pathways even if you're done with your OET and you have a letter of good standing, you can always apply and get the pathway approved. And then once you get your step two score, you can immediately be eligible for certification. So you can save time by doing that as well. So that's one thing.
That's a great advice, definitely. I mean, a lot of us who do not know that we can apply for pathways even without the step two score in hand, and you know that. So that definitely clears up a lot. So in your submission, and as well as when we looked at your profile, you have done a lot of research, and you also mentioned that you were interested in research right from in your medical school years. So like, what kind of research have you done till now, and how did you go about it?
So I started, I had my background in research in medical school when I worked on ICMR project in pediatrics. And that was like my introduction to actually learning a bit about basic research methodology and how you conduct a study. But honestly, I think I didn't do a lot in medical school. I guess, again, I started my journey quite late. So I didn't really have a lot of research projects, a lot of publications during medical school. So I think most of my publications were done once I graduated or during my internship period. So I think the way I started was, learned a bit about basic research methodology. I joined Research Update and they had a course on basic research methodology. So that helped me as well. And then I started learning how to write review papers through my friends whom I had met during my clerkship rotations. And we had a group and we started, trial and error, we started learning. So I think basically after looking at a few YouTube videos and looking at a few courses on scientific writing, it was very self-taught, I can say. But honestly, it took some time. And once we started writing review papers, whether it was literature, systematic reviews, I think from then on, it was a flow. And it was really interesting because I feel like research is always going to be a part of medicine, no matter what, like no matter which field you're in, it's always going to be a part. It's a very integral part of pushing medicine forward. So that's something that I always admired in research. And that's something that was one of the basis for us to start the Auto Research Initiative as well. So we wanted to make sure that, everyone had, like any IMG who reaches out to us will have I will be able to learn basic research methodology for free. So that was something that we really wanted to try to, put it out there. Yeah. And yeah, so that's pretty much been my research journey.
Definitely, your initiative has helped a lot of IMGs. I myself applied for it long back, and it's a great initiative. So yeah. So since you have a lot of research experience, so what do you think, what matters the most in the application? Your research, your USC, and how much weightage does home country research actually carry in your application?
So I think in order, I really believe that firstly, it's the scores, definitely, at least to get you through the filters. I mean, scores are not the end game, but they definitely are important up to a certain level, so they can push you through the filters so that your application kind of reaches the program. And then I think it also depends on whether you're visa requiring or non-visa requiring. That also gives you an advantage. Then, of course, your USC matters way more than anything else because they want to make sure that you had clinical experience in the US. So that is something that I saw that, you know, a lot of people who had more than 3 to 4 months of USC had statistically a higher number of interviews than those who had probably just, say, 1 month. I think the research and volunteering experiences kind of come hand to hand. It depends on the specialty. I think maybe internal medicine or surgery or neurology might be a bit more focused on research. Maybe pediatrics was, I mean, I was asked about my research because I had a lot of papers, but no friends of mine who have absolutely like no research papers or just one research paper who had really good number of interviews. So I don't think it was a very integral part, but it definitely boosts your application if you have any red flags or if anything else is pending. I would say that volunteering is also something that's really important. I think I was asked about my community advocacy projects a lot during my interviews. So I think that's also something to keep in mind because they do review your profile holistically and they want to make sure that, you know, you have kind of given back to the community and, you know, you're serving the purpose of being a doctor. So I think that also matters. So in order, that's also something that they do ask for. And, you know, it's always good to have a community outreach, all that. But yeah, so I think these are the things that matter during, you know, for them. I mean, from my personal experience, I think is what kind of mattered during when they selected for the interview.
That's really great. That's definitely good advice. So what kind of USC did you obtain? Like, you already mentioned that you had electives before you completed graduation and after that. So in total, I think you had like 5-6 months of USCE. What's your take on like if one should always go for electives and even if they can't get, you know, university electives, because with all the things going on, university electives are being more and more difficult to get into. So what's your take on agency electives and, you know, going through that and sort of like private practices and outpatient clinics and stuff?
So I think, yeah, university electives, I mean, they're probably opening up a lot more now. When I applied for electives, it was during peak COVID, so there were absolutely no universities open up, especially when I was just about to graduate and I had to do my electives. So I did do mine in private hospitals and I did do mine in community hospitals. So, and, you know, honestly, it was a good experience. But like when it comes to preference, I do think that they will prefer you having a university elective when compared to a community hospital and then compared to like a private clinic or an outpatient clinic elective. But at the end of the day, I believe any hands-on experience is always a must, whether it's a community hospital, whether it's a university hospital. You having hands-on experience is something that is very highly valued as compared to whether it's just an observership or shadowing, because, you know, they actually want to see in your letter of recommendation that you have actively worked with the patients and you have, you know, you have worked on the EMR and you know how to, you know how the healthcare system works. And that's something that really comes only with hands-on practice. So I think that is something that I would say, whether, you know, and definitely apply as many things that you can. I think now a lot of universities are like Cleveland Clinic and so many places are opening up. So there are a lot more options than what was there like a year or two ago. But definitely apply to as many places as you can. But in case you don't get in anywhere, definitely agencies can help. They can, you know, put you with private practice physicians or affiliated hospitals or anything of that sort. So just make sure that whatever you do, it's hands-on. I had 5 externships and 1 observership in total. So even after I graduated, I did like 2 externships and then I had 1 observership as well in a university. So definitely make the most of your opportunities, I would say, but definitely a hands-on experience sort of, you know, is better than an observership.
Okay. One thing that I want to ask here is that since you started with research in your medical school itself, that you started the ICMR projects and you had your professors to help you most likely. So someone who is a graduate and wants to get into research, what advice do you have for those people?
I think the best way to start with research in a very small scale way is case reports, because it's something that does not really require a lot of your time. And even if you're a graduate, obviously, be working and, you know, you'll be having some experience in your home country. So if you see an interesting case, you can talk to the doctor you're rotating with or working with, and you can write it up. So a case report is always on hand, and that's like the easiest way to start working on research papers, because once you start writing and, you know, you go through the whole process of publishing, kind of becomes easier to work on other papers. I know as a graduate it's really hard to get into original studies and, you know, find like a proper like PI and everything. But I feel like at the end of the day, if you can start small with case reports and literature reviews, I think these are things that definitely you can work on with a small group. And it's not really, it doesn't need like a lot of, you know, it doesn't need like a lot of studying, a lot of work to do. You can work like probably an hour a day. Even though, you know, when you're working normally, you can probably spend an hour a day of research and you'll be done by the end of the month or end of 2 months. So definitely start small with case reports or review papers. I think, you know, if you're going for observerships or externships, if you've graduated and, you know, in your hospital, if your doctor is working on a research project or a case report or anything, definitely ask them if you can help. And that's how I've seen a lot of other IMGs as well get their research experience, because they are, when they're rotating, they talk to their preceptors, and most of the preceptors will be involved in some of the other research projects. And you know, they can help. And nowadays a lot of things you can do online as well. You can work on Zoom, and you know, you can work on research remotely. So even if you come back, you can still work on data. So it's not really, I mean, I guess like reaching out would be the best way to do this. And I think one thing that a lot of other IMGs do is you apply for a research position, whether it's research assistant. I think that's also something that, you know, it will definitely help your CV if you have no research. I think Mayo Clinic normally takes in a lot of IMGs for research positions. So I think applying for those as well, and applying to universities, cold emailing professors, there's a lot you can do definitely as a graduate.
So you mentioned about research positions, like definitely we all know that's the 1 year contract or 2 years contract. So what's your take on IMGs, like getting into research positions right after the graduate, or especially when they are applying to not so competitive specialties?
So I would say that, for example, for internal medicine, you know, suppose you're done with all your steps and, you know, you're done with your USC and you have some time prior to applying and you have like maybe a year, like, you know, you're done with everything and you have almost a year, then I think applying to a research position would be fine. Because, you know, it'll give you a chance to, you know, be in the US and work in the US healthcare system and definitely be acquainted with the university where you're working in. That's also a really great way of making contacts and learning more about the university and also just, you know, integrating yourself with the system. So I think that definitely if you have the time, it's good, but I would recommend, you know, finishing all your other steps, your USC, prior to working on research, because like I said, apart from maybe surgical fields, when it comes to medicine, your scores, your USC, all of those are kind of like take a higher precedence than research. So don't really put all your focus on research and start working on research immediately after graduating. I think, you know, once you're done with like that whole part of your CV of USC and your scores and all of that, if you do have the time, definitely you can apply for a research position. And I think that some of them do have 6 months positions as well. I think also 1 year is like 6 months to 1 year is what normally the positions they offer, and it's usually unpaid. So yeah, I think that's something that you can definitely think about once you're done with the rest of your CV.
Okay, that's a great advice, definitely. So for you, like talking about the application, how was your LOR obtaining process and how many LORs did you finally upload?
So I uploaded 4 LORs out of the 6 places I rotated at. I think the process is fairly simple, especially when you're doing a rotation. You know, most receptors know that if you're an IMG, you definitely might need a letter of recommendation. But that being said, never take it for granted that you're going to get a letter of recommendation, because most of them are performance-based. So definitely give it your best in your rotation and, you know, work hard, go on time, be punctual, and show a genuine interest in the specialty where you're rotating at, and, you know, volunteer to stay longer, and definitely try to learn more about the system, not just for the LOR, but definitely you'll be a resident there in the future. So I think, you know, learning more about the system, learning the EMR will go a long way in integrating you in the system as a resident later on. So yeah, I guess obtaining an LOR normally around the 3rd or 4th week of your rotation, you know, you ask the preceptor that this is my last week, so I would really appreciate if I could get a letter of recommendation since I'm applying in so-and-so year, if you're applying the same year or the next year. So normally they say that your letter of recommendation should have like a very recent date. So if you're planning to apply maybe a year or two later, you don't need to ask them for the letter right away. You can definitely just, you know, correspond with them and give them your email address. And then when you're actually applying for ERAS, I think that's when you can ask them to upload their LOR. But like if you're applying the same year, I think that's completely fine. Once you get the ERAS token, you can send an LOR request and they'll upload it. So make sure that, you know, like it's a recent LOR. And I think recent USC also matters a lot. You know, they would prefer it within 1 to 2 years of applying. So make sure that, you know, you do most of your rotations within a year or two of actually applying to residency.
Okay, that's some great advice. So for the rest parts of the application, like personal statements, so what advice do you have for applicants out there to, you know, go about writing your personal statement in a very good way?
So I think with personal statement, the one thing that I would recommend is something that really helped me as well, because I wrote my personal statement in a very storyline form, and it kind of like conveyed the message as to why I was really interested in pediatrics, what inspired me to be a pediatrician, and what skills and qualities I've learned over the years that I can dedicate to my residency program. So it's your personal statement has to be your story, as well as, you know, kind of showcasing your skills, or if you've faced any setback that you've overcome, something personal to you that really gives a nice touch to your application, because they already have your application where they look at your professional achievements, but personal statement is a way for them to get to know you as a person. So I think that gives a humanity side to your application that's really important. So definitely start writing it as a rough draft. It's going to take time, because I know it's really hard to put out your life story in like one page, but definitely it's going to, you know, it's a process. So I started writing my personal statement in, I think, August, and that's when I actually had one draft ready, but it wasn't like the greatest draft. So I kept modifying it here and there. So I, you know, over a month, I kind of finished like the final draft, and that's what I sent out to my mentors, and I asked them to review it. So definitely ask, you know, even if no one else, you can ask your parents, your friends, anyone to read the personal statement for you, so that they have a better idea, because they know you as a person. They can tell you probably what is like reflecting and what could be written better. I didn't really use any editing service for my personal statement, because Grammarly did the work for me. But definitely if you do need, you can always use an editing service. But I think at the end of the day, you know, you write it from your heart, and you really write about what inspired you to do your specialty and be a pediatrician or an internist or anything. I think that's pretty much what they look for. It has to be very personalized. So don't make it generic. Don't copy off the internet. Write it from scratch, and definitely write a lot of personal anecdotes into it. I think that's something that'll help.
That's some very good advice. I actually wanted to ask you something. So since everyone on the USMB journey, given that it's a very, very long journey, faces some or the other, you know, hurdle, or there's a phase when you feel down and not being able to, you know, go ahead with the journey. So with respect to your journey, what struggles did you face and how did you overcome them?
So I think the one thing that all of us face is the fact that the journey is so uncertain. You know, it's like it has its ups and downs, and there are times where you realize that, you know, it's taking so long, and you know, you don't really have the certainty that you're going to be a resident. You don't know when that's going to happen. So definitely uncertainty is a big fear that most of us IMGs have, because, you know, you see online and you read so many horror stories of people not matching for 5-6 years, and you're like, is this what I'm going to be doing? And it's really hard. It's a really hard position to be at. So, I mean, USMLE as a journey, I feel like, this is something that I tell almost everyone I talk to. I'm like, you know, if you want to take up USMLE as a journey, make sure that you're ready for it. Because I know it sounds glamorous to be a resident in the United States, but you need to put in a lot of hard work and you need to give it time. You know, there's so much studying to do. There are so many exams. Exams itself are like, you know, the 8-9 hours. So it's really hard, you know, as coming from India, especially when we've had only 2 or 3 hour exams, and writing a 9 hour exam is really hard for us. So I think, you know, probably adjusting to that itself and accepting the fact that you're probably going to see your friends become residents sooner than you in your home country, and you're still studying for a year or two. I think that's something that definitely might put everyone down. Yeah. But like I said, at the end of the day, there's always light at the end of the tunnel. And I think another thing, it's not a setback, I would say, but definitely after I was done with my step one, I wasn't very happy with my score. I scored a 229 on my step one, so I was not extremely happy with the way the score turned out. But I think that was a time where I was at my lowest, and I had no idea, you know, because everyone says that 240 is the standard for IMGs, and you know, you won't get interviews if you don't have 240s. And that's something that really scared me. And, you know, I was like, should I go ahead with the journey? But, you know, that being said, now when I reflect back, I think that setback kind of like pushed me to do way better on CK, and I scored like a 245 on CK, so it was a good improvement. I also did my step three, but I think like more than that, I mean I feel like my application was kind of reviewed more holistically, because I ended up getting almost 16 interviews, and I think at the end of the day, when I look back and I see my application, I feel like more than the scores, like what was really asked to me during my interviews was about like the projects I had done, the advocacy, community advocacy projects I had participated in. And, you know, just, they just wanted to get to know me as a person. So I feel like if your application kind of speaks out about your personality, I think that's also really important. Like I said, scores are like a way to get your application through the filters, but it also does matter that you have a complete application and it's a well-rounded applicant. So, I mean, I think looking back, I think I worried a lot about my step one score. And if anyone out there is listening and you also have the same worry and, you know, you have a lesser step one score or any of that sort, don't really worry too much about it. Try to do better in your other exams. That's what I did. But at the end of the day, you can still get a lot of interviews. Like I got almost 16 interviews and with a 229 on my step one, which is something that I would have never imagined. Maybe once I got my step one score, I would have never imagined this scenario. So it's definitely a holistic review.
Definitely, that's very relaxing for me because as you said that everyone like around me told me around step one that if you don't score like, you know, 240 or 245, then your rotation doesn't stand anywhere. And getting a low score, like I was in 230s or 237 actually. So I was definitely not very happy with my score. But yeah, this thing relaxed me a lot to, you know, hear about that, how applications are holistically reviewed. So thank you for that.
They're definitely holistically reviewed. And I think like some of my co-applicants and like people I've been seeing during my journey, you know, they have like really good scores, but they don't like, they haven't had many USC experiences or clerkships or observerships or less research or no volunteering. And they've gotten very less number of interviews. So like I said, the scores are not the end game because, you know, they do see your application holistically. And, you know, the more you kind of like have different experiences on your application and it kind of makes you a more unique applicant. And that's something that really draws their attention. So definitely, I mean, scores are not everything. So I know they're important, but they're not so important that you give up on the journey or you feel like you're lesser of an applicant. So this is something that I wish someone told me maybe a year and a half before. So this is why I'm putting it out there that it's definitely okay to have like one low score. It's completely fine.
Definitely. That's a great advice. So you have talked a lot about, you know, being involved in community advocacy programs and outreach and volunteer activities. So as an IMG, like especially since you're from India, so what community programs do you recommend that one can go for or can get actively involved in?
So I think like for volunteering specifically, I feel like, you know, you can approach any NGO, non-governmental organization, or any organization like Rotaract or Red Cross. I mean, these are present in almost every city. So definitely you can approach them and say that, you know, I'm a doctor and I want to volunteer, or I'm a medical student and I want to volunteer. And trust me, they have so many health camps that they need help with conducting. There's also Switch India, which is another pan-India organization that you can volunteer with. I think Project IMG also has mental health volunteering. So you can definitely volunteer, you know, online for that. So that's also an easier way. If you're probably in a city where you do not have in-person volunteering options, you can do that. So I guess at the end of the day, really giving back to the community in a way that in any way you can. If you're in medical school, and you can probably talk to your community medicine department or your PNSM department, and you can ask them like, you know, are they kind of, because they normally conduct a lot of health camps. So you can ask them if you can volunteer with them as well. So I think for volunteering, there's no dearth of opportunities. It really depends on, you know, where you're staying, but definitely try your best to volunteer, especially in, you know, in the field you like. Like I volunteered a lot with kids, you know, whether it was conducting health camps or whether it was, you know, conducting menstrual hygiene drives, whether it was, you know, starting my own helpline called the Safe Space. So basically, you know, it was just like volunteering a lot with kids because something I'm really interested in. But, you know, there are so many other opportunities. There are so many old age homes where you can conduct health camps. There's so many diabetic health camps that are conducted regularly in India. So yeah, definitely you can just reach out and ask. I think they'll always say yes because volunteering is always a need.
That's definitely a great advice again. So one last thing that I want to ask you here is like, what's your take on letter of interest and, you know, sending them early in the season and even before the season starts? Because I actually got this advice from some people to start sending them very, very early whenever you can. So what's your take on that?
So I sent out letters of interest, I think maybe in the third week of October. And I feel like they do help. You know, I know a lot of people say that almost everyone sends them and they don't really help. But I think they do. I think if your application is good, and you want a way to highlight it and you know, because sometimes it does get lost in the sea of applicants. There's so many thousands of people applying. So definitely if you've written a personalized letter of interest and you want to say you have a reason for you know, applying to that program and really wanting to match in that program. For example, if you have family in that state or city, or you know, if you've rotated in that hospital and you already have, you know, experience working there. So it can be anything. It can even be like a personalized way of like, you always wanted to move to that city or you have friends there or anything of that sort. And what really appeals to you about the program? So I think the main thing about letters of interest is that they have to be personalized to the program, and it really kind of should show why you're interested in the program. That's one thing. But I do feel like they help, because, you know, I sent out a couple, maybe it was in the third week of October, and I got like a lot of invitations in the fourth week of October. So I don't really know if it was because of the letter of interest I sent or because it was just the time of when I got my interviews. But I do know that, you know, a lot of people have gotten responses to the letters of interest as well, and they've gotten invited to the same program. So it's obviously a good way to send them out. As for sending it before the application cycle, I don't think it's going to help as much. Maybe you can send it to a couple of programs that you really, really want to match in, like, you know, your top 5 or top 10 programs. But at the end of the day, they don't really have your application, so they have nothing to kind of judge you against. But it's no harm. I mean, I do know a couple of people who send them in June or July, and it's kind of like showing an early interest. But I think with onset of signaling and having that, and, you know, signaling your programs during the supplemental application, like your top 5 or top 7 programs, I think that kind of takes away the whole point of sending a letter of interest prior. So I think I would definitely recommend to send it like within, like after 3 weeks, like maybe if you've applied in September end, maybe in like October 2nd week end or October 3rd week would be a good time to start sending your LOIs.
Thank you, Dr. Chaitanya. That's a great advice again. So about signaling and supplemental exam application, do you have any particular advice on that and how to go about it?
So I think this was the first year they had signaling for pediatrics. So I don't really know if they used it as much as, I don't know if all programs used it. I think the one thing that really mattered was geographical signaling, you know, signaling areas where you want to match in, like whether like the certain states that you can put in, like the I think it was like grouped into like a couple of districts, I'm not very sure, but basically it was like east, south, and all of that. I think geographical signaling is something that really played a role, and also like signaling programs. I think some programs really sent out the invites to people who had signaled them earlier and then to the rest of them later. I think it would probably play a good quite a good role during ranking as well. They might rank the applicants who signal them higher, as well as, you know, even compared to other applicants. So I think that's probably, you know, two aspects of supplemental application that I feel did play a role this year for IMGs. But I think apart from that, you know, when it comes to writing your experiences, I mean, it's a nice personal touch. You know, you kind of talk about what really helped you, what you learned from the experiences that you're putting on your supplemental letters. But at the end of the day, I mean, I think I don't really know how much of an importance those experiences have when it comes to your final application. But definitely signaling and your geographical preferences are something that I've seen programs looking at.
That's a great advice again. So, like, what other advice do you have or a message to the IMGs listening to this interview today?
I guess never give up. I mean, like, you know, I know the journey is like so hard. And sometimes, like, you just want to, like, you just want to wonder when it's going to end and is it all worth it at the end of the day? But I know it's really hard. But don't give up and believe in yourself and believe in your own application. And, you know, and don't really judge yourself based on the number of interviews you've gotten. Even if you got like a lesser number of interviews, like if you have like 2 or 3 interviews or 5 interviews, it does not matter because you just need one interview to match. So make sure you give it your best. Like the Elmhurst Mount Sinai was the second program that I interviewed at, and that was it. Like I got my pre-match offer a week later. So, you know, I had like a couple of interviews, like almost like 14 interviews pending, which I had to cancel. So, you know, it doesn't really matter, like I said, how many interviews I've gotten, because I never ended up attending those interviews and I got the pre-match offer. So it really depends on how much you believe in yourself and your application, and definitely never give up and be cheerful and optimistic. And if you have like a low score, like I said, it's not the end of the world. So don't worry about that. And definitely keep yourself going. It's like a really long journey, but it's going to be worth it.
That's a great message to keep our spirits up, you know. So it was great hearing from you and having you with us today. And we wish you nothing less than, you know, all the great success in your life. And so with that,
thank you so much.
And thank you for being with us. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Paral. It was awesome. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Dr. Chaitanya.